It's time to focus on today's educational issues. Issues that affect you, your kids, community, and your tax dollars. Topics like violence, legislation, special needs, the gifted, curriculum, technology, the parents' role, building self-esteem, and minorities' needs. How do we deal with substance abuse, AIDS, sports, and very importantly, funding?
Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadjia Varney, your host. With much of the country's attention focused on high-stakes testing and accountability, few people have the opportunity to step back and talk about, are these policies that are driving education and affecting our communities, are they really serving our students, our communities, and indeed our democracy? Well, today I'm just honored to welcome a Massachusetts senator who has been at the forefront caring about community service and especially about education. It's my personal delight and an honor to welcome Senator Marc Pacheco. Welcome, Senator Pacheco.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for having me on the show.
Well, thank you. I know that you have been on before.
I have a couple times. It's been a while, though, since the last one. Yeah.
I think one time we met, there was a high school event happening, and we had all sorts of, it was connected to television again, mm-hmm. I think in Foxborough, Mass.
That's correct.
That may have been the first time I met you and saw your interest in education. Mm-hmm. Well, before we talk about the policies driving education, today I'd like to talk about both community service and how that's connected to education and our students. And recently I read that you and Senator Ted Kennedy and others were at some event celebrating Jumpstart, which I think is part of AmeriCorp.
Correct.
So first of all, could you tell us, what is AmeriCorp?
Well, AmeriCorp is, it's a federal initiative that encompasses over 3,100, not-for-profit groups, faith-based organizations, school systems, etc., and a whole range of opportunities for people of all ages to be involved with service. And service learning, educational, in our educational system is a big part of that. And we have service learning initiatives funded in part through AmeriCorp with health care and housing and you name the area, there are opportunities for young people to learn and serve.
Now, can you give me an example? What do you mean by serving, that a student would serve in health care?
Well, it's applied learning. I'll give you an example. In my district, my senatorial district, we began a program a number of years ago, funded in part by AmeriCorp and the Massachusetts Service Alliance here in the state of Massachusetts, in cooperation with a community hospital, Morton Hospital in Taunton, Mass. And we started a health corps. It's primarily an applied learning opportunity for those students that are in a nursing program, LPNs going on to be an RN, RNs going on to be a nurse practitioner. And they would work through their educational institutions and the hospital doing preventative care out in the community so that it's a win-win-win. People in the community that otherwise would not have the opportunity to be seen by an education by a healthcare professional actually see somebody that's already licensed at some level, a licensed practical nurse, for example, going on to be an RN, their applied learning, it takes place not only in the classroom, but then is applied in the community, in the real world. So it's real world learning.
This sounds so good. It seems to me, just before we went on the air, I think you said, help me if I made a mistake, but I think you said elementary, that the AmeriCorp actually works in the younger grades. What you're talking about sounds like maybe a student studying at a community college to be a nurse or whatever. But how does it work at an elementary or high school?
Well, service learning in general can work right from kindergarten right up through higher education. And that's what's so exciting about it. When you really think about it, it's really just a way of learning. It's one of the learning styles, mm-hmm. applied learning. Mm-hmm. And It's great when you see many of our educators out there in our K through 12 system throughout our state and throughout the nation that use applied learning methods every day of the week in classes. There are school systems. School systems like the Sharon School System, the Hudson School System in Massachusetts, and there are numbers of them in Wayham, Massachusetts, and other places across the communities across the state, where the entire school system tries to have service learning be a component of their educational philosophy.
Well, you know, that sounds so very important, because it does build what my main focus is in education, is to build thinking citizens who can solve problems. And when you're out there in the real world, it's not just a worksheet on your desk that somebody's given you, but you're applying it to the real world. Usually vocational schools have been the ones who have been the most active in that in the past, but...
Right, because people see the vocational education curriculum as a way in which, well, there's a tangible result when they get through, whether it's in the trades, what we used to call the trades part of the curriculum, and you'd see a piece of furniture at the end
there
of the day,
mm-hmm.
Whatever it happens to be. But it's the same today in technology. There are many people that are involved in technology that are behind. You know, students that are involved behind the cameras or working in studios that you've worked in over
years,
and they learn from that. They apply that learning. In Massachusetts today, literally hundreds of schools are putting in place mentoring programs
mm-hmm.
where you have older students working with younger students
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
With tutorial programs, mentoring, and trying to help them achieve a better outcome
mm-hmm,
for
mm-hmm.
their education. And also, it sends another message as well. It's about community. It's about one person caring about another, about one human being caring about the outcome of another. And I think it sends a very important message that we all need to be focusing probably a little bit more on today than we have in the past.
You know, I am so happy you just added that at the end, because one of my own fears, and it's not just mine, but some very prolific and well-known authors are constantly writing about the problem of looking at service learning, which can be so good, with the goal that you just spoke about, and that is building community and democracy and not just making little workers for some industry. So I thank you for doing that. And maybe now is a good time to shift into the idea of what's driving the public schools, the policies.
Mm-hmm.
And since education reform acts have been everywhere. Now, Senator Pacheco, you and I know that every new administration that comes in says, look at those schools, we'll fix them. So, I mean, this is sort of a perennial, just over and over, our schools never seem to measure up. So we now have more education reform, and now it's coming from the federal level. But what do you say, there's so much pressure, as I said in my open, about accountability and competition and high stakes and so forth. What do you say to the parent or the teachers who believe that no child should be denied a diploma based on one test? And I know that's a controversial question right now.
Well, it is quite controversial. And some of the things that you said just prior to asking me the question about the one test, and I'll get to that in a minute.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a lot of the reasons why we have the testing, they're very relevant. We are in a mode right now, in a global race to be the best in terms of what's happening with this 21st century economy. And education is so important. Our maths, our science curriculum, the ability for our young people to do well, to understand, to be competent, and to have good outcomes, is so important. So there is a focus trying to, you know, people say, well, you're teaching to the test, whatever the next slogan happens to be about how you're going to get these young people to be doing better and get passing marks on that test. But there is a reason for all of that focus. I happen to believe that the MCAS test that we have in Massachusetts has made us all focus on trying to do a better job, both hopefully people at home, the family, which is a big part of all of this, and usually that's left out of the equation. It's usually the teachers and the school, and so. But there's also support systems, which we call a home or a family or some mentor, that needs to be a support system when the student is away from school. That all needs we all need to be partners in education. So I think the testing is important. But should it be just one test? Mm-hmm. Well, I was a co-sponsor of the Education Reform Act of 1993, and it was never supposed to be one test. It was supposed to be a system of tests, a system, so that there may be, and we just spoke about it at the beginning part of the interview, students that are very good in terms of looking at their total portfolio and what they could bring to our society, our community of people, you know, upon the graduation of high school, for example, at that level. And sometimes that one test will not properly measure all that a student can bring to our society. And so I think we need to look at a broader set of tests that can be applied instead of just using one test. But I do think it is important that we have measurable outcomes that we use to measure success. Because because let's face it, we need to be graduating students at the end of the day. We need to be graduating students. They're going to be able to do the work, you know, in our society, be able to be successful when they go on to higher education, be able to be successful when they go into the business world.
Well, that's, I think that your focus and your goals sound, you know, very laudable and commendable, because you're focusing on using the tests and a portfolio, looking at the whole student. And some of the teachers have voiced concern because some people are not looking at that fuller view, as you say, a system of trying to use the test to see where are we, what are we doing, the correct use of tests. I just, I won't ask you to answer this, but did you go to school with no tests? I mean, I've taught for 30 years, and so this whole idea that
never,
we never
had no tests.
Exactly.
always had testing.
So there's a larger view here, and, and also I think we need to temper all of this excitement about testing as though, you know, this is something innovative and new. But again, it's what you said at the beginning really impressed me, in that it's helping the nation maybe focus away from consumerism and buying the new car or all of our other international needs. Maybe that's one of the major values that you pointed out, to focus parents, schools, on back on education. When we come back, we're going to take a break right now. And when we come back, I did want to put before you a few controversial people who are afraid that perhaps we are letting the marketplace dictate what education should be too much. So talk with you when we come back. Good. This is very important. You need to know what's happening with your schools. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Come on, David. Come on, David.
Let's go, David. Come on.
Come on, David. You got the love.
Get as involved in your kids' education as in everything they do. And imagine the success they might find. Stay in touch with the teacher. Visit the school. For more tips, call 1-800-281-1313.
Go, David! Go, David!
Senator Pacheco, there is criticism out there. Actually, David Kirp, Dr. David Kirp, a professor of public policy at the University of California, Berkeley, he wrote a book called Shakespeare, Einstein, and the Bottom Line. And his subtitle is, and I'll read it, The Marketing of Higher Education. Now, talking at higher ed, they're afraid that there's a trend in academia now to have all these business values in the marketplace running what's happening. Do you think that we're in danger of treating our students more like commodities, getting them ready to just be workers, instead of critical thinking citizens, part of a community in a democracy?
Well, I think the goal of public higher education should be to do both. Should be to make sure that we graduate critical thinkers that have a world view, that understand both the business world and also have an appreciation for the arts, and can be creative thinkers, critical thinkers in our society. And I think that's what the strength is, quite frankly, of the American education system, that we have been a system here in America that allows people to think outside the box, not just a very narrow view of the world. So I think it's very important. But I also think that we definitely need to make sure that we're able to compete on par with any other place in the world who are graduating, folks that are going to be out there working in the business world. Because just from a very pragmatic view, if we're going to be able to compete and win in the 21st century economy, we have to be doing that. It is in our self-interest as a society to do so.
Again, I like the way you phrase that, because so often all we hear about is competition. Mm-hmm. And any good teacher, any good psychologist knows that competing against oneself with passion and something you're interested in makes much better quality and much better results than trying to beat out somebody else. I mean, in football, that may be a different case, but even the leaders in football say they're, Tom Brady of our New England Patriots will say that he's just competing, he's always trying to be better himself. And it comes out well for everyone. So I'm so glad you put the balance on that, and not just the competition. There's a subject that we have to approach if we're talking about education, public education, and we both went to public schools along in our careers, the importance of funding. Now, people don't hear much about what's going on, and I know that it's very important. I think it was Jonathan Kozol who's been writing more and more about, well, his newest book is The Shame of the Nation, and his subtitle is The Restoration of Apartheid Schooling in America. So where we may be failing in our funding, even though we're talking about that all the time, for students in the inner cities, which are mostly minorities, and we're getting more and more separation between the poverty and minority schools and wealthier communities. What do you want to say about the funding of and the equality of reaching education for all, since you are a public school advocate?
Well, I think Kozol's title is right on. It is the shame of our nation that in the urban systems all across our great country, as great as we are, as much as we have accomplished as a society, there is a walking away from the type of investment that really needs to be made in these systems. And some of the investments need to be made not just in the traditional way. We were talking earlier about the importance of the partnership within education. Not only the funding needs to be there, that's very critical, because we can talk all we want about great curriculum and textbooks. I mean, you can't do too much if they're not on the shelf.
That's,
I mean, you need to have the textbooks. You need to have good quality educators that are in front of a classroom. You have to have a decent class size to be able to have that interaction and positive outcome for students. But students also have to have a support system. So, and unfortunately, in many a young child's situation that are out there, especially in the urban centers where poverty is very high, and the drug issues are so much a big deal, and not that they're not a big deal in some of the suburbs as well. It's a big deal all over the place. Mm. But there are many more problems people that many of these young people are dealing with without support systems at home. And so, not that we want to create the government family. God knows we don't want to do that. But we do have to put in place before and after school programs, other ways in which we have mentoring systems. And that's why I love these service learning opportunities for young people, because not only does it give them another way to apply the learning that they're having in school, but it's another way for them to connect with people in community, in people who are connected to a young child in any way, then it's an automatic human response to want to make sure that that child is successful. Mm-hmm. And having that child be successful means that school system has to be successful. And then that's about the community. Mm-hmm. It's really about creating opportunity in communities. And it is a shame. And the public funding is a major piece. But I would say, let's make no mistake about it, it's not the only piece. There are other community support systems that need to be there.
And it's interesting because we hear that the economy is getting better, maybe overall, but then I speak to people in the inner cities and in small towns like where I live, and they say, yeah, there are more jobs. I have two of them. So, you know, people are working very hard, so it's very hard for them to even... One of the reasons it drove me to start this show 20 years ago was when my principal and I sat together and I said, the parents are all beginning to work. They can't come in for anything. We need to do public access television. And that's the purpose, of course, for part of the purpose for this show. Coming back to what you just said, though, so well, thank you for always mentioning that human element, that these are not little widgets going through a factory. I really appreciate that, and I'm sure our viewers do. But the real reality and the reality is the funding is important. You said we have
yes.
to buy the books, they have to be there. Well, there is a Pulitzer Prize winning investigative reporter who's written another book called Perfectly Legal, and he documents, in fact, that the super rich and high people, CEOs and corporations and super rich, not people just doing well, they are evading their fair share of taxes. They have many, many loopholes. And quoting him, he says, it's making the burden heavier on everybody else. And we hear about tax reform. I actually, on C-SPAN, watched some of the goings-on, you know, the discussions. But we don't hear much about, in fact, we're talking about tax breaks for those very same people whose taxes disappear. What can we do about helping people see the need for paying their fair share of taxes?
Well, I think when people are asked and they are given the facts about where we are in our society and the need to invest, you see it all the time in communities when they have a override question is before them for the schools or an override question for public safety, and they've done their homework and they've investigated as a citizen, and they know that for their future and for their children's future and their grandchildren's future, that investment needs to be made. We've always stepped up to the plate as Americans to do that. The problem is when you have leaders that are not willing to take that chance and trust all of us as citizens, and would rather use the political capital in helping their friends. We see a lot of that happening in Washington nowadays.
Well, the scandals are all
and
out there
it's,
right now.
It's amazing what's going on with the tax breaks that are continuing to be pushed for the mega-rich in our society. We look at what has happened, if there was any better way to describe this, I can't think of one. When we look at all of those things that we saw on TV at home, when we saw what took place with Katrina, terrible. We had a national priority to try to go in and try to help there. Now we're in the process of trying to figure out how to do that, how to pay for that as a country and Louisiana as a state and other states that were impacted. Unfortunately, we were never asked as a society, other than through not-for-profit agencies, to try to help out. And at the same time, the federal government now, in order to pay for the Katrina relief, that the investment that we are now making, we are cutting programs in education, cutting programs for the poor, mm-hmm. cutting programs on housing. Mm-hmm. So quite frankly, how we're paying for it is we have a state where a disproportionate share of the people that were impacted negatively were poor and disenfranchised individuals who lost everything. And the way we're paying for that is to take it from other poor and disenfranchised individuals.
Isn't that crazy?
That is outrageous.
Where is the outrage about that?
And unfortunately...
And giving tax breaks to the very top people.
Yeah, it's outrageous. Mm-hmm. And we here in Massachusetts are very lucky because our entire federal delegation have continually spoken out about this. They've tried to cut back on the tax loopholes that are in place. Here in Massachusetts, we in the legislature have closed millions and millions of dollars of tax loopholes, giveaway loopholes that have been created over the years. We have much more to do in that regard, and I support doing that because I think we do have to bring equity and fairness into our tax system.
Mm-hmm. I was quite shocked when I read the book that I just referred to, Perfectly Legal, when he said that the people top less than 1% mm-hmm. have increased 220-some%. He's a Pulitzer Prize-winning investigator. Mm-hmm. And the people in the middle have stayed rather flat, and the poor people have gone down. Now, with that insight published, I must stop editorializing because our time is running out, and I just want to ask you one last question, and you can pick either one. Your greatest frustration about helping education right now and guiding it, or your greatest hope, if you want to end on the problem or if you want to end
on... Well, I'll try to end up on a positive aspect. For all the criticism, and we have a lot of critics out there, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, people that are not in the ring usually are on the outside criticizing about our educational system. Mm-hmm. And I must say that we have wonderful educators all across Massachusetts that are doing a fantastic job mm-hmm. every day of the week helping our young people in sometimes very challenging situations. Mm-hmm. We have... great administrators, great people that are working at the local level, trying to do the best with what they have to work with. And despite all the criticism, when you look at the national testing results that just took place, Massachusetts was number one again.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Senator Pacheco, and I hope you'll come back and talk to us again.
I look forward to it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
In closing, if education is indeed more than just having kids pass tests and memorizing facts, if it's more than that, and if we have continued our American unique vision of education, of quality education for all people, then all of us have to be aware of the policies that are governing our schools, be aware of what's happening in our communities, and support things like the AmeriCorps, because we need to give our opinions to our elected officials. They need to hear our school talk.
Join the discussion. Send your comments to schooltalk@bridgew.edu.